recap of what we did till now. We took a look at how a basic class looks like, something like this. Start with Java. Then we understood what this function means. Public static void main. We printed this message on the console, as you can see. Then we had a look at access modifiers over here. For Java, for class and variables and methods. Then we had a look at Java coding conventions. Then we took a look at how you create a Java project and create a source folder in Eclipse. So I hope this much part is clear to you all. Hello?
Yes, Ravi.
Okay. So
the
other thing is we have to create all our Java files into source folder. I hope that is also understood. So now if we want to, start creating classes, we should always create a specific package inside a source folder. Now, why package? Creating Java files with default package is discouraged, as we should have a proper folder structure when we are creating any framework or starting with a Java project. That is the only reason we can have our Java classes with the default package as well, or without package, as you can say, but that is discouraged. We should always have a package and our Java classes grouped into specific package which defines specific activity. So I have created one package over here, com.takecanvas.start. I would show you how to create a package inside a source folder. Just click on new, right click on this source folder, create, click on new, go to package, click on this package. You can start naming it as and how you wish to do it, but the convention is the dot convention that we follow when creating a package. So I would love to name is that com start Java basic, something like this, but we are working with Tech Canvas, so we should work like it's a commercial one. That is why com, then the company name, Tech Canvas, then the project name that we would be working on, supposedly demo, since this is a demo project, and we can name it and leave it as it is. So we would be having this new package created in the source folder. So this part is clear to all you guys right till now, how creating a new package inside a source folder?
Yes, Ravi.
Okay. Now creating a Java class file. So right click on the folder that you have created, package. On that, click on this class icon. Now you have to name it with a capital letter. If you start with a small letter, see, there is a message. Type name is discouraged by convention. Java type name should always start with a uppercase letter, as we have already discussed. So we should, if you name it with a small letter, it will still compile the code, but then this type of coding convention is discouraged. So we should always name a class with a capital letter. So this is how you create a class. We can name it as demo. Now there are some options over here. We can have a main function created in the class directly when we check this checkbox, public static void main. If you want a main function to be created automatically by the IDE, we can always check this checkbox, click on finish, and a main function is directly created for us. Now what is this todo? When you compile the code, this todo tells the compiler that there is some future implementation, remaining in the code, and the creator of this code has to do something else. So that's why there is a todo tag over here. to do, and whatever you want to implement in future, you can write that message here. I want to create a code. And if you see, you go to this, I want to create a code. That message would be displayed to you. This is just a comment that is there in the code. So there is one more important thing now that we should discuss first before moving ahead with the coding part, and that is introducing comments. So comments in Java. Now there are two types of comments that you can have in Java. One is single line comment. Use to add single line comment. This is only valid for a single line. If you want to use multiple line comments, use and start and dash to close the comment. So this is how we give comments in Java. Single line comments, use double forward slash. For multiple line comments, use forward slash start to start this multiple line comment, and use star forward slash to close the comment.
Ravi, comments are using in Java to describe what the statement explains.
Yes, whatever logic that we implement, we should always have comments in Java so that the other person who is going through your code or have performing a review of your code should understand what your code is exactly doing.
Okay.
So whatever functions that you write, you should always include comments in the steps that you include in your function. That is the purpose of comments.
Okay.
The other thing is, there is one more multiple line comment that you can use. This is to start and this to end. Now, what is this multiple line comment? This would be treated as a Java doc. When you compile a code, this Java doc would be, displayed to the user that what exactly that function is doing at the time of compilation. When you hover over a simple function, for example, this main function, you see nothing, void, something like this. There is absolutely no description. But when you hover over a function which has a Java doc, something like this, then at the time of compilation, if you see parameters and arguments, so it will have everything that you write in this part. What this function does, the main function to execute the code. So if you now hover over this, whatever message that you have written, you can always view that with that specific function. Since this is the same class, so you can see this comment written in this. But if you are using an instance of this class somewhere else and you are calling a function, then you can always hover over the function called and you can always understand what that function is going to do. So I hope this commenting part is clear to you all. To just demo how you are implementing multiple line comments, let me see. So this is what a single line comment is. This is what a multiple line comment is. So any doubts till now? Hello?
No.
So this commenting part is understood with Java doc?
Yes.
I hope you have understood what is the significance of introducing Java docs, because we can always understand what a function defined in other class is doing just by, you know, getting the preview of that function, something like this.
Okay.
So now we should start doing something with Java. So as you can see, this class, it has some variables, a string, float, double, char, etc. and etc. Now what I want to do is create getters and setters. What are getters and setters? Getters and setters are basically accessors and value setters for variables defined in a class. How you have to create getters and setters? Just select all these variables as I have done. Go to source, generate getters and setters for all the functions. As you can see.
What does it do? I mean, the getters and setters.
Sorry?
What does the getters and setters do?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to explain you in further detail. I'm just showing you like how you create getters and setters first.
Okay.
Yeah. So when you do that, the getters and setters for all the elements would be created. If you take a look at this, get A, set A, get B, get set B, get C, set C, and something like this, get X and set X. So what these getter setters actually do? We have talked about this access modifier private. Supposedly you don't want the variables defined in a class to be accessed outside the class directly, and that is what the basic feature of encapsulation is in object oriented programming. We always hide the variables from user access directly, so we always define variables as private, and only defining variables as public as per the requirement of the class and execution. So by default, we always define a variable as private until and unless there is a specific need to have that variable accessed at the runtime. So we define those variables as private. So when we define those variables as private, we cannot directly access those variables outside the class in which it is defined. To do that, we create some public functions, which are getters and setters. For example, this variable, integer variable A, is a private variable. Now this variable cannot be accessed outside the class 1. So if there is another class 2, which wants to access those variables, so what I'm going to do is create an object of class 1 and call the getters and setters for those class, as I've done here. Now, before that, let us just understand how an object is defined for a class. If you can see this, let me add just a single line comment defining an object of class 1. So this is how you define an object. Take a look at the syntax, how you do it. It's name of the class, object name, a new keyword, name of the class again, parenthesis and semicolon. So if we take a look at it again defining an object syntax. It is class name, object name equal to new, again class name, parenthesis, and a semicolon. So this is how you define a object. Now this has to be the same keyword that you have used for class to create an object of that same class. So any doubts in creating an object? Hello? Hello? Yeah, any doubts in creating an object in the syntax?
No, Ravi, it is clear.
Clear, right? So,
yeah.
Megha, can you explain how we have defined a class object, class one object over here?
It would be starting with a class name.
Yes.
Space the object name equal to new, and again the class name.
Yeah.
With the parenthesis and a semicolon.
Okay. So this is how you are defining a object. Now, why parenthesis? Now this thing defines that we are calling constructor of class one. By default, a class always has a constructor, even if you don't explicitly define it. So a class always has a default constructor. Even if it is an abstract class, it always has a constructor. So by default, every class has a constructor. And we are calling that constructor so that we can initialize this object to the instance of class one. That is what this variable, this syntax means.
Class one in the 12th line, class one dot set x and r. So we have using that one also somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, these are the setter values. We are setting the values of variables that we have defined in class one. I'm going to explain all these things. I'm just now concentrating on how we define an object first so that you are not confused when we are going to these parts. So I hope you are clear with this object concept, how it is defined and what it exactly means. Okay. Okay, so this is the standard for accessing any accessing functions. And variables using objects.
Ravi, I had a question.
Yeah.
If I try to declare two objects for a class, and I use the same name for both of them, then like what?
Object name. Yeah, same. You cannot define two objects with the same name.
Same name, that would create a problem.
Yeah, that would not compile only because you already have one object. So if you create another same object, then the compiler would be confused to allocate memory to each object. So it won't compile the objects if you define with the same. That is the reason.
Okay.
So you can only have a unique object defined for a class, but you can have multiple objects for the same class as per your need. So I can have, right now I have one object for this class. As you can see, class one, class one. I can have another object of class one. I can have third object again for class one as and when I want. And I can destroy the objects of class one using a destructor. So constructors and destructors, we would be looking on those concepts sometime later in today's session. Right now, we should know how to access a function and a variable from a different class. That is what we want to do right now. So the convention is, if you want to access a variable or a function from a different class, the syntax is object name dot operator. We have to use a dot operator. Variable name, variable, and semicolon. If you want to assign a value to a variable, we can always assign some value and a semicolon. Or if you want to access a function, then it is object name dot function name, name, parenthesis, and a semicolon. This is how you access a function from a different class. So I hope these syntaxes are clear to you. Hello?
Yeah, Ravi.
Hello?
It is clear.
It is So, now getting back to getters and setters. So, first we would have a look at setters. So what are setters? Setters are basically used to set a value for an attribute or a variable inside a class. So what setters will do is, it will set a value for the variable, and after that, whenever we want to access the value that we have set, it can be used using a getter, something like this. So for variable A inside class 1, this is the function to set the value of variable A. If you can see, it has a parameter int, and it can have any name on this. You can name it anything. It's not necessary to name it as A only again over here. The only thing is, if you name it the same as the variable defined in the class globally, then you have to use a this pointer. We would go to a this pointer sometime later, because right now we want to concentrate on how getters and setters work. So this is a setter function. So what we are doing is, whatever value that we are passing in this function, we would be assigning that value to this variable A through this. Or if you want to understand it something better, suppose I have A equal to XYZ, if I pass parameter as XYZ in this int XYZ, it would be something like A equal to XYZ. This is how you assign a variable, assign a value to a variable. So this part is clear to you all?
By using this particular command, I'm setting the value of A to 10 publicly in other classes as well.
You are, right now this is a default assignment, if you see this.
Yeah.
Private int A. Now this, because this is a private variable, I cannot access this outside class 1.
Mm-hmm.
That is the limitation. So if there is another class, class 2, if I want to access the value of that variable, I can use get A. It will return me a value of 10. If I directly use this without using this, if I comment this out and I'm running this code just to show you. So let me just run. If you see this, see, getting variable A, the value is 10.
Okay.
Because default assignment to this variable initially done.
Okay.
Assign a value.
As it is a private variable, so in the other class, like I'm only able to access the value because I've used the get and the set function.
Yeah, you have used a getter, not a setter.
Okay.
To get the value which is assigned to this variable. That is the function of a getter function. That is what a getter function does. It will return you the value which is stored in variable A.
Okay, and what will be the setter doing?
Setter will set a new value to that variable. So
okay.
I have defined this value. See this.
Okay. Okay.
Class 1 set A as 100. So now if I compile the code, it will give me a value of 100 that we have set over from this part. So this is basically the what a getter and setter do. So I hope you are clear in this part.
Yeah, I'm clear.
Okay. So Sunita, are you clear on this part?
Yeah, Ravi.
Yeah. Okay. So this is what basically a getter and setter would do in you for you in your class. I hope you have your laptops or systems with you in the next session so that we can, you know, practice out the coding part and have some hands-on training also going on with this session so that we are not stuck anywhere. In any case, before the next session, I would request all you guys to have the things installed in your system and, you know, practice all these things in your system before the next class so that you are through with the concept that we are going to cover in today's session.
Okay.
Yeah. And if you guys come across with any questions or doubts, you can always contact me.
Ravi, one doubt I had for the last topic which you covered. For printing, we have to use the get statement also, always.
If you are setting a value, you cannot, since it's a private variable, you cannot get that attribute directly from the class. So you have to use a getter function. If it's a public variable, I'm just going to show you how to access public variables as well. If it's a public variable, you can use it directly. That I am going to show you. So this is my email ID. You can reach out to me on this, or this is my contact number for you. You can contact me on this number as well if you want. If you have come across any doubt while installing the Java in your machine, or if you have some problems with Eclipse and creating classes, projects in Eclipse or anything, you can always reach out to me.
Thank you.
Yeah. So this was all about getters and setters. Now let us create one more object of this to demonstrate the public variable. So I would have class 1, a new object, ABC equal to new class 1. Now what I would do is I would access a public variable defined in class 1, which is this. You see this public string variable, my name, which has a string value, that is my name, Ravi Kumar Rai. So I'm going to access this variable now. If I want, I can assign it a value directly. How to assign value to a public variable? ABC dot my name equal to whatever. So let us assign this as Sunita. So clear on this part, accessing public variables and assigning a value. So if I run this, so if now I want to print this value again, I would do something like this, system.out.println. And I would print it, abc.myName. So this would print the name. It's So if I run this code, you see this, now the value has changed. I have assigned it a default value, something like this. It's my initially Ravi Kumar Rai, but when I access that same public variable and assign it a different value, you see that thing is changed. So I hope you are getting this, how accessing public variables and assigning a value to a public variable. Now, all these functions that you are calling in this with this object class one, these are all public functions. If any of these functions are made private, again, you cannot access them outside this class. So there might be some functions which you need to do some modifications or logic implementation inside the same class, and you don't want that functions, you know, to be accessed outside the class. So you need to define that with an access modifier as private. So this is what basic, somewhat basic concept of what class is, variables inside the class, public and private methods, getters and setters, of accessing, creating an object, accessing public and private data members in a different class, and say basically setting and getting their values as per the object requirement. So any doubts till now in this, that in all the topics covered till now, any questions that comes to your mind?
My abc.myName, we have defined it inside the public thing, that's why we are not directly, we can print this, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And the public variable, we can access it in this manner, object.variable. If we are defining it as private, we cannot access this. So if you want to see this, I can make this as private.
Yeah.
So once I define it as private, then you can see this. There would be an error message. My name is not visible. You cannot access it directly.
Okay.
Yeah. And you cannot manipulate that variable as per your requirements.
Okay. Okay.
If you want to access it directly, you have to make it as public.
Public.
Yes. The same way, supposedly I make this as private. So if you see, now I cannot access this function again. Method is not visible. So this is what basically private and public does. It puts some restrictions on the access of variables and methods in Java. So this
that class, we can use this if it's a private.
Yeah, but inside the same class, class one, I can use this one anywhere I want, as and how I want. So supposedly I just uncomment this main function. Okay. Now, since this is a private variable again, if you can see.
Okay.
So I would be printing int a value. Since this is inside the same class, I can access it anywhere.
Okay.
And supposedly I have this private function get a. So I can again use that function as well. If I don't want to use it, something like this, I can put this get a and this. So again. So if you can see this. Using get a command. So if you see this, int a value is 10. So even though it's a private function, inside the same class I can access it. Or I can simply use the variable a as well. It will again say print me the same value. If you see, the getter function is also doing the same thing as the variable.
Yeah.
So I hope the function of getters and setters is clear to you right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let me just change the things now once again. So we should now move to the concept of constructors and destructors. Now, before we understand this, whatever the code that we write, after running the code, there is a thing known as garbage collector in Java. What that garbage collector does is it destroys all the variables that were being used in the class for the execution, and removes the variable memory allocation that was assigned to each function and variable during the course of execution. Because each class requires a specific amount of memory as per the variables and the functions defined inside the class. So the garbage collector then removes all the memory allocation once the execution of that class is done. That is what the function of garbage collector is. We don't have to specifically deallocate a memory in Java. The garbage collector takes care of the same. That is the major advantage in Java. But if you want to specifically deallocate a memory or unassigned value assigned to a variable and deallocate memory of that for that variable, you can use something like destructor in Java. So we would be looking at constructor today. Since destructor is not majorly used, so we won't be stepping into it, and it's not that significant from the point of view of automation. So we would be looking at how we can create constructors in Java. So if we see this class, this is the syntax for a constructor. Public name of the class, parenthesis, and curly braces. So if you want to check out what the syntax is, then it is something like this: access modifier, class name, parenthesis, and initializing variables. Now, what major function of this constructor is that it initializes the value for all the variables that you define in the class. Even if you don't have a constructor, the constructor would assign a default value to any type of variable that you define in a class. For example, if we go to this class, if we don't assign a value to this, I have assigned a value as 10. If I don't assign a value to this variable, I just leave it out as A. So, it would assign it as a default value of 0. For example, if I don't assign any value to this string variable, it would assign it a by default value of null. If you want to verify this, we can go to this class. We can run this as well. You see, we got the default value of that variable as zero since it has no value assigned and constructor has assigned it a by default value as zero. If you want to access the public variable to see what it has in its name, then you can again run this code and you see there's a default value of null. That means it has nothing stored in the string variable. So I hope this thing is clear to you. Why do we use constructors? Hello? Hello?
Ravi?
Yes?
Can you please explain this concepts, like this concept of constructor once more?
Okay. You see, constructors are basically used to initialize variables, whatever variables that we define in a class. So for, I'm starting with the default constructor. If we don't assign a constructor in this class, as I have not done, even then it will assign by default value to all the variables which are created in this class. So for example, I've just removed the assignment to this variable and I've just defined it as private int a with no value. So when I'm executing this command, getting variable A, it's returning me a value of zero, which is assigned to it by the default constructor, which is already assigned to that class when it is compiled at run, compiled and then executed. Even if I don't mention a constructor inside a class, it always has a default constructor, which assigns a default value to a variable. So So if you want to understand what the default values are, then for example, for integer, it is always zero. For a string, it is always null. For a decimal value, it will be like 0.0.
Mm-hmm.
So in something like that. So it would be always in this manner. So if I just unassign a char variable as well, if I want to do something like this, and when now I execute this code, if you see, then let's have a take a look at what char is. See, there is nothing assigned in it.
Okay.
So it's again a null and we get a zero. If we modify this, it is, we are giving as 35.0. Supposedly, if we don't assign a value to this B as well, then we get as 0.0. So I hope this concept is clear to you guys.
Yeah.
Only thing is that my name is Shwetnad.
Sorry?
So, I mean, what is the difference between that null and zero?
Where?
The first output which came in, the my name code equal to then zero, null.
Yeah.
Yeah, that this one.
This one. So, you want to understand how this null is?
Yeah.
See, this is a public variable inside the class. It has no default value assigned to it.
Okay.
So by default, constructor assigns a value of null inside the string variable.
Okay.
That is by default.
Okay.
You will always get a null value in this string if you don't assign it a value and try to get a value in this. So more queries, Madhurya, are you clear about this? See, you have to understand all these values are by default. Don't have the control over these. That constructor assigns these values to it by default. Okay. If you don't assign a value, then constructor will assign a value something like this.
Okay.
Demonstrate.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so now we would be creating a constructor in this class. So as you can see, there are two string variables in this class, my qualification and college name. Okay. So for now, we should not be concentrating on this static part of the code. There is this constructor. So it is defined as public hello. Now this a major significant value about constructor is it doesn't have a return type, even though it is a function only. As you can see, this is also a function, but it's a special type of function. A constructor does not have any return type, that you have to understand. So we never even include this keyword void with a constructor. If you see this, there would be a message that would come out. So we always define a constructor with this syntax. They don't have any return types, and we don't even include void keyword as a return type in constructor. Now this constructor is initializing this string variable with the value of BEEXTC. There are two ways in which we can assign a variable, which is a global variable for a class, which is defined outside any function, any variable defined outside the main function, and the functions inside the class are global variables. They have access throughout the class. So they can be assigned value in three ways. Number one is by direct assignment, something like this. Or the second way is the getters and setters, as I've already demonstrated. And the third way is through constructor. So I'm just assigning the value as BEEXTC for this variable, my qualification. Now there is another variable, college name. Right now I have no allocation to this college name. Now constructor can be of two types. Constructor of functions can be of two types. We have not covered this part in case of functions. I have just missed this part. So let me just cover this part first. I just forgot this part. So functions can have parameters. For example, public void any function. Now this is a simple function with no parameters. Since you are not passing any parameters in this parenthesis, this is a function without any parameter. So I should include with no parameters. To work with. Now there are other type of functions with parameters. So again, the same function, public void, any function. I can have any data type as a parameter and any amount of parameters. So for example, int a, if you want to add more parameters, you can add them by including a comma. So I can go on adding parameters by using comma in this manner, int a, then float b, then string ab, something like this, and I can go on adding parameters as much as I want. There is no restriction on how much parameters that you should use, but we should avoid using multiple parameters if there are more than 10, and we should pass them as an array of parameters. So we would be looking at arrays in our next session, but for now, this is how we define a function with parameters, and we can manipulate these parameters inside this body. So clear with this part, function with no parameters and function with parameters. Sunita? Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Sunita, you are clear with this part, right? Function with parameters.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. So now getting back to this constructor part. So this constructor now has two parameters, string college name and qualification. So I would be using these parameters to initialize these two variables. As you can clearly see this. For now, let me comment this part. So let me just print out these values first so that you can understand what exactly is happening. You see, initially I have assigned a value to this string variable, my qualification. So it has by default a value of bextc. Since I have not assigned any value to this string variable, and inside my default constructor as well, I have not assigned any value to this, so it is displayed as null. If you see this object now, so Madhurya, can you hear me?
Yeah, Ravi.
Yeah, so can you tell me which constructor I'm calling for this hello variable? Default one or the parameterized one?
It's the default one.
Yes. So what it should print? Only one value or both the values?
It should print only one value.
Only one value. That's what is exactly being printed over in this place. So only the value for my qualification and null value for college name. Now I have this second variable for the class hello, and I have called this constructor. So so Megha, hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this which constructor I have called in this scenario, can you tell me?
Yeah, I have initialized the constructor.
Which one? The first one or the second one? From these two. Which is the one?
Can you please go down?
Yeah. For this object, which is the constructor that I have called? The first one or the second one? out of these two, which is the one that I have called? And this.
The second one.
Yes. Since this has two parameters, string and string, and this also has two parameters, string and string. Now, you have to understand this, that you cannot jumble up these parameters. These have to be in the sequence in the way that you have defined it in the function. If I have an integer here and a string here, then I have to define an integer here and a string here. I cannot interchange their positions, since the compiler would give me an error if I interchange their positions. That you have to understand. Maintaining the sequence of parameters in functions is very important.
We can define as many as parameters inside it, right?
Yes. Yes, but if we have more amount of parameters, then we can go for objects or arrays instead of multiple parameters. So this is the second object for the same class hello. Now when I'm printing out the values, you can see this printing out the value that I've assigned in this constructor. Clearly you can see this. Whatever value that I'm passing in this, it is assigning this value. So if you see this, the value that I'm passing in this, Vivek College, BSCIT. So it is printing those values here. So any doubts in constructors, default or parameterized constructor?
No, not at all.
Now there is one more thing to understand. Supposedly I only have a parameterized constructor in a class and no empty constructor, then I cannot call this one. This I cannot create an object with a default constructor. If you want to check, you can always comment this out. Now you will see an error in this constructor with no parameters is not defined. So are you able to understand this? Hello?
Yeah.
So Sunita, are you able to get this?
That means we are not trying to initialize the object in the main.
The thing is, if you are having a parameterized constructor, then the compiler, you know, doesn't care about having a default constructor. You need to have a default constructor specifically defined in case you have a parameterized one. If you don't have a parameterized one, then there is no issue. If you want to verify this, you can just comment this out. And if you see, that error has just gone away. By default, it will have a constructor with no parameters. But if you define a constructor with parameters, it will not allow you to create an object with default constructor. So this is what the concept is about constructors. So I hope you guys are clear about this.
So that hello, new hello, there it is calling the default one only, right? That one.
Yes.
So anyways, it is calling. We are commenting out that thing there.
Yeah. I mean, if I'm commenting out this part, see.
Not that one. The upper one.
Yeah.
Public hello. Even if I'm,
that is what the concept is. Even if I don't define a normal constructor without any parameters, it will still have a default constructor by default. The compiler provides it. That's when I ran this class, see, class 2. When I ran this class, it assigns some values. See this. This is all coming from default constructor.
Okay.
Even if I don't define it, the compiler would give me a default constructor at runtime.
Okay.
Okay. But if I define a parameterized constructor, I have to specifically define
the parameter.
I have to specifically define a default as well. That is the mandate. That is the concept. If you don't want parameters in your constructor, then it's up to you. But if you have a parameterized constructor, then you need to have a default one as well.
Okay.
Yeah. Let me just uncomment this. So there is one more way of assigning, you know, variables and calling functions in a class. That is a static block. Now what? This static block is very powerful, since if you don't have the static block, the first thing that would be executed when you are creating an object is the constructor method. But this static block is even more powerful than the constructor. The static block is always defined even before a constructor call. So if you want to, you know, check how the order of execution is in a class, then let me just execute this block as well. So if you notice this, see, first the static block is executed, then the way the constructors are called in this main function from the objects. So this is the power of static block. But the limitation is only static methods and static variables can be accessed, or you can say that is the limitation of static block. But it is more powerful than constructor because it is executed as the first thing if you are having a static block in your Java class. So any doubt in this static block? Megha?
Static is a method, means you're not passing any parameter.
This is what you can say, similar to constructor only, but you don't have to, you know, mention the name of the class. Why? Because static is independent of a class. It is always assigned a fixed memory allocation when you run a class, independent of objects.
Is it a function? Means we can pass the parameters there?
No. You cannot pass any parameters in this. You see the definition of this static. It's just static, then curly braces. Similar to function. Only thing is, you cannot have parameters in this. You can only have static methods and static variables access in this. You can only use static methods and static variables. So this is the power of static block. But this is not used in Java program mainly, because you do need to have parameters and other things, you know, to manipulate and build logic for your scripts. So we would not be using static blocks, but just to give you a small idea like how the order of execution in a code is, so I have defined a static block as well. So till now we have covered classes, objects, constructors, access modifiers, data types in Java. So once again, like, any questions before moving ahead to conditional loops? That would be the last part for our last topic for the day.
No, Ravi.
So Megha, do you have any?
Ravi, for the static part, actually I just missed a little bit of it. So it is not audible.
Sorry?
The static part, I just missed something because the was not audible to me. Can you please once explain the static part?
Okay. This static block is executed as the first thing in your Java. When you create an object, the first thing that is called is the constructor if you don't have a static block. When you execute it, when I have commented this out, okay, now see this, see my function. I am creating objects and accessing variables. So when I run it, I'm getting values as assigned through the constructors itself. Okay. Now, if I want to do something in this static block, for example, I'm just printing out this message from static block. So this would be the first thing that is executed, and then only constructors would be called and values will be assigned to the variables. So if you want to verify this, just check this. You see, the first statement is from static block.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the thing which is executed as the first thing in a class. And after that, the constructors comes in and then only the functions. This is how the order of execution is. So to list down this order of execution, number one, static block. Number two, constructors. Then number three, functions. This is how the execution happens. So I think you are, now you guys are clear about this.
Yes.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm clear.
Yeah, okay. So Madhurya, what about you?
Yeah, Ravi, I'm clear too.
Okay. Sunita, you are also clear about this?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So now we would be moving up to the conditional statements part. So let's just take a look at this slide to understand. Now, what are control statements? The first point that you need to understand is control statements have their existence only inside methods or functions in Java. They cannot have independent existence. So any logic that you want to implement, that would be done through a control statement, and that would be defined inside a method. So this is the first point you have to remember. Now, control statements are of three different types. The first one is selection, second is iteration, and the third one is jump statement. So let's take a look at the selection part first. That consists of three type of selection control statement. The first is if else if ladder, and the third one is switch. So we would look at these statements today, along with the iteration statement for for. Whereas if time permits, we would go to do while loop as well, but we would be concentrating on these loops initially. So let's go to this class. I have some sample code already defined for this class. So this is how my if
Hello.
Yeah. Hello. Hello. Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, actually, I was not able to hear. Hello. Yeah, actually, I was not able to hear you.
Okay. Yeah, now my voice is audible to you right now.
Yeah, right now it's audible.
Yeah. So this is what is the basic structure of an if-else loop. If you see this. Now, why to go for conditional statement? If you want to validate for a particular condition, whether it is true or false, we go for this if else conditional statement. The part which would come in this would always be a condition which would check if a particular thing is true or false. That is how the thing goes. But before that, we need to understand what are conditional operators. So, so these are the conditional operators that you can see on the screen. First one is logical AND or double ampersand operator. Second is logical OR or double pipe operator. And this is how you implement them inside the parenthesis for an if loop. And this is what the values are when you are verifying a certain condition. For a value A and B false, if you go for an AND condition, it would always be a false one. If you go for an OR condition, again, this would be a false one. If A is false and B is true, then A or B would be true, but A and B would be false. For this condition to be true, both A and B has to be true so that this condition would be true. This is how we implement AND logic, and this is how we implement OR logic. So this thing is clear to you guys? Hello? Hello?
Yes,
clear to you guys? I'm audible or my voice is breaking in between?
No, it's audible.
It's available, right? Okay. So this is how the logical table is for the two major AND and OR operators that we use in if loops. Just wanted to have a small overview to you guys how these things works. So this is how it is. So let's go to the if block then. The if statement is a powerful decision-making statement and used to control the flow of execution of statements. It's a two-way decision statement and is used in construction with an expression. General form is, the syntax for this if loop is in this way. If testing for a condition, either true or false, then execute this, or else execute the else block. To understand this better, let us go into the code, or let me just show a preview of this. So if loop would be like if condition, if this condition is true, then I would do something if condition is true. Now, if this condition is not true, then we need to do something else. That is why we have an else block. So this would do something. Condition is false. So I hope you guys are able to understand this, how we implement this if loop. I am testing for a particular condition which can be either true or false. If that is true, the code will go into this block of if and do something. If that is not true, then it will skip this block. It will go to else and do something. So, Sunita, are you clear about this? Hello?
Yeah, Ravi.
Okay. So let us take a look at our code right now. If you see, there is a condition. If the string value is null, then do something and assign a value. If in the else condition, it will assign a value by default. Okay, so let me go to this. So if you see this object right now, there's a hello object, which is initialized using this default constructor. Now I will be calling this function condition test to verify if this condition is satisfied. If my qualification value is null, then it should execute this part, or else it should assign my qualification as the value BA. So let me ask this. So Sunita, are you able to hear me? Hello?
Yeah, Ravi.
So there's a question for you. See this object. This is calling a default constructor for hello class. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Just take a look at these variables right now. See, this is not assigned any value, this string variable, and I would be calling this constructor.
Okay.
Okay. So I am now calling this condition test for this if loop. So what do you think? What value would be printed for my qualification? Just take a look at this function and tell
me. Since it is you're passing no value, it should be qualification.
It should be this value. That's what you're saying. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's run this and see if you're correct. Just run this again. So if you see, I have this value of BA instead of BE printed for that value. You might be thinking like, why it should be printing this value of BE to me? Right, Sunita?
Yeah. No, actually, what was the... can you repeat the question, actually? What?
Yeah.
You were saying that...
I am assigning it as a default constructor, okay? to this object.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I'm calling this function to check this condition, whether the string has a null value or no value is assigned to the string.
It is assigned.
I'm checking for this condition. If this is true, then whatever value that I'm passing to this qualification would go to my qualification. Or else I'm assigning a default value. By this execution, you can see it is printing a value BA.
Yeah.
Okay. So, why has this condition happened?
Actually, the my qualification value, you have not defined anything above, right?
Yeah.
Above, it is null. It is null.
But
here, as per the condition, if my qualification is null, then it should print my qualification equal to qualification. So the qualification you are passing is BE, but it is printing
this BA. One. But it is going to else part and not if part. Why is the question? It should go to this part.
Okay. Is there any other construct?
If you see this carefully, there is a default constructor over here and I have already assigned it a value. So it is not null and hence it goes to this else statement.
Okay.
So you understood?
Because
I have already initialized
I missed out that value that you have assigned my qualification equal to default.
No, supposedly if I don't do anything in this, I just comment out this part as well.
Then that would be...
It should be going to this part, if loop.
If part.
Yes. So if I rerun this code, then it is BE.
BE.
So I hope you have understood how this if else condition loop. Right?
Yeah.
What about me? Hello? Megha?
Yeah. Yes, sorry. Yes, I've understood it.
Okay. So the next part in if else is if else if ladder in the conditional statement. What is if else if ladder? Suppose you have multiple conditions to test instead of only one that you have tested as something like a string value is null. If I want to test two statements, two conditions, because I have C, I have two strings. Now, if I want to check if both the strings are null, then I can go for this if else if ladder as well. Something like this. If condition one do something, if condition one is true, okay, or else if there is one more condition two, then go to this block, do something if condition 2 is true, and it can go on else if condition 3 and so on, like it can go on like this as much as you want, as many as condition that you want to test, you can use this if else if ladder. The only thing is, in the end, you have to have an else statement, because if neither of these conditions are true, then you need to have an else statement so that the false condition is executed. So You are clear. I hope you are clear with the structure of how if else if looks. Let's take an example of if else if ladder here in our present code. So when I would just decomment this part. So now I'm checking for two conditions. So Madhurya, can you, hello? Madhurya?
Yeah,
hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so my question is to you right now.
Yeah.
See. Now the same condition, okay? My qualification is null. Then it would assign this value. This is what this thing is doing. Now there is another condition. If college name is null, then assign college name as VG Vase.
Okay.
Okay. Else my qualification would be BA. That's what you can do. Now, if I want to reach this condition, okay, then it means college name has to be null. Just take a look at this part. These are the two variables. Here is my default constructor, and here is the parameterized constructor.
Okay.
Now, I would be using this object, hello2.
Okay.
And I would be calling that function. So hello2 dot condition test. And what is your qualification, Madhurya?
BE
branch?
EXTC.
EXTC. Okay. So let us see and what thing is executed. So if you see, it has printed as BE and null. Now, why has this happened? Can you explain? See, it tested for this condition. It tested for this condition. And then it just went to this part.
Okay. And the college name, it has not taken odds. It took the if statement qualification. There is BE.
Yeah.
Because we pass the parameter into that. My qualification equal to qualification.
See, my constructor is this one. I'm stressing on this part because I want you to understand how exactly constructor works and how parameterized constructor works and how this conditional loops also work so that you don't have any doubts.
Here my qualification is we have given.
So if you take a look at this thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we are assigning some values to these variables. So hello to condition test, and I'm just passing a parameter that is required to be. Printed. So when I execute this code, see, it is printing me the value.
Okay.
As BA and Vivek College instead of BEEXTC that I have passed it. Why? Because it has gone to this part.
Else statement.
Because neither of these conditions are true.
Okay.
Have you understood this?
Yeah, I got the BA, but I have doubt for the Vivek College, which it got printed.
Vivek College?
Yeah, the college name it printed as Vivek College.
You have initialized this.
Okay.
With the college name and qualification.
Qualification.
Okay. So the college name as well as the qualification is holding some value and it is not null. So when it will go into this is false because it is not null. Again, this is also false.
Yeah, right.
So it will also skip this part and it will go to this. Now here I'm hard coding the value, assigning it value as BA instead of the BSc IT that I have passed over here.
Yeah, that's how it printed. Okay.
So if you want to, you know, verify it again, you see this. Initially, it has printed BSc IT and Vivek College.
Yeah.
But after this condition, this function, it has printed as BA and Vivek College. Why? Because it went to this, the value changed from BSc IT to BA.
Okay, just because BA was hard-coded inside that, that's why the degree got printed as, qualification got printed as BA. And also
the college name is not changed because there is no action performed.
Okay, got it.
Okay. So, Mega, hello?
Yes, Rafi.
Yeah, so now the next question is to you. Okay. Okay, so now I'm just going to this constructor, okay? And I'm just commenting out this part. I'm commenting out both the assignments. Mm-hmm. So if you see now, there is no assignment to these variables in the parameterized constructor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
Or let me just, if because I want to test the else if condition. So, okay, let's have both the values as null. Okay, so what would happen is, let me also include a breakpoint so that you are able to understand how this thing is exactly working. So when I debug this code, okay, you see, because both the values were null. Okay, so it first went to this condition. Now, see, it has gone inside because this condition was true.
Yeah.
Yeah, so now it will change the qualification name to what we have assigned.
Okay.
As BE. As you can see in this. Can you see this? Java.doc qualification equal to BE, the value that we passed from the function. So my qualification is assigned a certain value. As you can see this, the values are null initially. Okay. Now, when I execute for the next condition, you can see this. Since both the values are null, okay, so both the conditions are true. It is unable to, you know, decide which loop it has to be into. That is why there is an error over here.
Okay.
So, you are testing for a certain condition. That is what I want you to make understand as. You can only test for a specific condition to be true when you are using a conditional loop. Either condition 1 can be true or condition 2 can be true. And if both are false, then it would go to an if else.
Okay.
Okay. Now if I just uncomment this part. Okay. Uncomment this part. Now my qualification is not null. So what should happen? What do you think? What would happen in this function then? Which part of the function would be executed? if loop or if else loop or else loop?
I think else if loop will also be executed because the college name is coming as null. And the else loop will also be executed because I'm getting a qualification.
So let's run, just run this code. There would be only one condition which would be executed, and that is this. Because college name is no.
Okay, right, right.
Okay?
Yeah.
As I explained it to you, there would be only one statement which would be executed, and after that it will exit this conditional statement.
Okay.
It will be out of it. That is how the logic works. If you want one condition to be true, you set that condition and you implement a logic for that condition. If you want another condition to be true, implement a logic for that condition. And if there is a default case that neither of them are true, then you can go for the default case in the else loop. So this is how if else if ladder works. So I hope you are clear with this part.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, thank
you. Okay. So Sunita and Madhurya, do you have any confusion regarding this?
No,
no. No, right?
No. Yeah, yeah, I'm also clear.
Okay.
Just one
okay.
thing I wanted to ask, that we can uncomment anything inside the else if. Can we uncomment directly the if else statement altogether?
Sorry, can you speak a bit louder?
Like, we are uncommenting the statement inside the if or else, but can we directly uncomment altogether whole if else statement?
Which one?
Like public void condition text string qualification you have given. So under that, in the 27, yeah. So in the 27 line, yeah. The whole thing can be uncomment altogether.
This one part, this part.
From 27 to 48. I mean, 35th is the, again, else statement is there. Yeah.
No, you cannot have an else, only else statement. There is an, and then there is an else. It something okay. can be true or false, so you need to have true and false both together.
Okay,
there are two sides of a coin, so you cannot distinguish between them. They exist together in the same way. You have an if and you have an else.
Okay,
without if there is no else.
Okay, yeah,
so this is if else if. Now, let's go to another conditional statement, that is switch. So here is the condition which would go inside. Actually, this is a variable, sorry, not a condition. Variable on which you need to check a condition. Conditions. So after that, there would be case A or case 1, do something, thing, and then break. Case 2, again the same thing, do something and break. So this is how the basic structure is, and there would be, you can continue something like this with case up to case n as you want. You can have hundreds of conditions in a switch case. Now the advantage of this switch case is we are not, you know, advised to use and if else if ladder if there are more than 5 conditions, and we are advised to use a switch case. So a switch case is much more powerful than an if else if ladder. We will understand this, how this is executed. Do something and break, and there's a default condition as well, just like else, as we have already discussed. If nothing of these cases are true, then it will go to the default. So let's take an example of switch case. Public void test switch. So this is how switch case looks like. I would use the switch case for this variable. My qualification, then case, since this is a string, so I should use something like this. If my qualification is, you can say case one is null. You can have it in default, I think. So if you go for the first one, that is BE, then sysout, or do some specific actions that you want with that case. In this case, I'm just printing out a message. I am an engineer. In case my qualification is BA, then I would print a message like, I am an artist. Then again, you need to include this break statement for every case, so that it comes out of this switch case if a particular condition is true. By default, I am a graduate. So if you see this statement clearly, I would be testing the variable my qualification and check what its content is. As you can see, so I would be creating a new object now. Let me comment out all this part. Don't need this. So I would be creating a new object. Hello 3 equal to new hello. I would be using my parameterized constructor for this. I would be giving it as Somaya College and DE. Then I would be using like hello3 dot So, if I don't put any value in this, so Omega, what do you think, which message from this would be printed in switch? Hello?
Yeah.
So Omega, what do you think, which message would be printed?
Can you go down once?
Yeah. See, I am assigning a college name, but I am not assigning any name for the degree. Okay.
Okay.
So if let me even make this as null in case you are confused.
Okay.
So that value is null. So now what do you think, which condition would be executed in this? From these three conditions, what must be printed? Either engineer or artist or graduate?
It will be graduate. I'm a graduate.
Okay. You have, as you have seen this, I did it specifically. Since I'm checking for a condition, I have not checked it if this value is null. If this value is null, there is no condition for it. As you can see, there is no condition to test if this string variable is holding a null value. In case that happens, there would be an exception throwing null pointer exception. So I would be just changing this to an empty statement. So now what do you think? It's an empty string. It has no value. So now what do you think? Would this statement be executed now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's
see.
Forgot to initialize this variable, I'm sorry. Yeah, so as you can see, I am a graduate message is displayed. Now if I want to test for a specific condition, BA, be passing BA in this. So if I run this, I am an artist. So that's how you test each and every case for a particular variable. So I hope this switch case is clear to you guys. So Sunita, if you haven't, do you have any doubts over this switch case?
No, Ravi.
No? Madhuri, are you?
No, Ravi.
And Megha?
No, Ravi.
Clear, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So the final conditional statement for today that we would be covering, that is the for loop. These things we have already covered, nested if else if ladder statements. This is the one that we have covered just now, the switch statement, its syntax. If you want, you can refer this slide on LinkedIn. I would be sharing you the URL. This is a very good content. And this thing explains, you know, each and every condition block very nicely. So I would be sending you the link for this, or maybe Shivangi would mail you the link for this PPT. And you can always refer this PPT to get more idea about what conditional statements are exactly doing and in what kind of cases can we create each and different type of control statements. So let us go to the for loop. The for loop is basically an iteration statement. iteration means running something for a specified number of times till a condition is true. That would be an iteration statement. So for loop would keep on running and running and running till a particular condition is true. That is what this for loop does. So let us take a look at the syntax for this for loop. It is initialization, expression, and increment. Now, before we go to for loop, since this has an increment operator mentioned, let us just understand what an increment operator is. An increment operator is defined by plus plus sign. Now, if you assign this increment operator before a variable, something, if I have a variable A, then what it will do is it will increment the value of A and then do something. You can do something. Now, supposedly, if I use this A plus plus, this is again the same. It will increment the value of A by 1. And this is again increment the value of A by 1. But what is the difference? This is the pre-increment operator. This is the post-increment operator. If I'm using something like this in my code, for example, let me just have an integer variable to explain you clearly. Int C equal to 1. Hello, 3.c plus plus. Let me just put a print message. So what do you think, Sunita? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, so what do you think? What would be the value printed?
Can you go up?
Since this is an increment operator, it will increment a value of C by 1. So,
yeah.
But this is a post-increment operator. So what do you think would be the value printed in the message? See, the initial value is 1.
Yeah.
I'm increasing it by a value 1. So what do you think would be printed?
The function, the for loop, can you?
No, I'm not executing any for loop. I'm right now explaining the concept of increment operator. So I'm just incrementing the value of variable C by 1 by doing something like this.
The value for C was initialized
to 1. Initialized to 1, yes.
So it will be 2.
It will be 2. That's what you think, right? Let's see. It is still 1. Now you would be asking like why? Because this is a post increment operator. It will print this value and then only increment it. And now if I print the value of C again, okay, just see this. I am just printing the value of C now. If you see this, this is an increment operator. After that, I am printing the value of C again.
Okay.
Now it will be 2. See this. So you understood?
Yeah.
This is a post increment operator. What it will do is it will do some action and then increment it if you are using it in this manner.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you use pre increment operator, instead of post increment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. Then there itself, it should print 2.
It should print 2.
Okay.
Instead of 1.
2 and 3. 2 should.
Yes. it should be 2. So that is the difference between pre-increment,
post-increment
and post-increment. Now all these things are not there in the slide, so I am basically depicting this by on the notepad. So to make you understand like how the things, you know, work when you are using an iteration statement. So let's go to the for loop now. I would just comment this out. So I think I have already created a function for for loop. So you, if you can see this for loop, it has initialization, condition, and increment. So what I'm doing is I'm initializing a variable, integer variable I, to a value of 0. Now what I want, now this is the condition for how much do I want this for loop to, you know, go on executing. That condition is defined in this part. So right now my condition is till the value of I is less than 20, this thing should go on executing. And I'm then incrementing the value of I. So what do you think, Megha? Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what do you think, for how much, for how many value of I would this print message would go on executing?
Up to 19 it will execute.
Yes. So let me just print this statement. So hello 3 dot. Test for loop. So when I execute this, I am able to increment that for loop 20 times till the value of I was less than 20. So I hope this for loop part is clear to you guys. You set the condition over this for how much period you want this iteration to keep on going. This is the condition that would decide the course of iteration, and this is the increment that you want to do for the iterative value. If you want to understand this better, this is the index, starting index for the loop. This is the increment value, the increment for which the thing would go on executing, and this is the condition. Now if I set this as 10 instead of 0, so how many values will it print out? Madhurya, can you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, Ravi, I can hear you.
Yeah, so for how, which values of I, what is the range that it would execute?
It will be printed for I equal to 10, you are asking, right?
Yes.
It will be printed from 10 to 19.
Yes. Just take a look at this. So it has printed from 10 to 19. So this is how the for loop works. You need to decide the index, starting index, the condition, and the increment. And for that particular condition, this will go on executing till this condition is encountered, and then it will go out of the loop. That is how this thing works. So I hope this for loop is clear to you. Yeah, Megha, hello?
Yeah, just one doubt I had. We have put the sysout and a pre operator plus I at the end in the sysout statement. So it is not like, suppose I have 10, so it is not printing from 11, it is printing 10 itself. So I am having the statement sysout plus I at the end.
You want it to be something like this?
No. I'm saying that we have the sysout statement, which is saying that print the value of I, but there is a pre-increment operator, plus I, at the end, in the sysout statement.
No. This is not a pre-increment operator. This is basically you are concatenating two strings. This is a concatenating operator in Java.
Okay.
So don't mistake it. Increment operator is always a binary sign, plus plus. It is not a single sign.
Okay.
A double.
If we pre-increment this operator, then it will be printed as 11 to 19, right?
Let's see what it does. So if you see, it is still printing from 10 to 19 only. Okay. You would be thinking like, why it is happening like this? Yeah. The initial value of index is 10 only. This would be done only when this thing is executed. It doesn't matter if you give it as plus plus I or I plus plus. In this case, I just wanted to explain you this pre and post increment operator in case you are working inside a function and not with a loop, for loop. When you're working inside a function, with a variable like this, since where I have like this. When you're working with a variable,
maybe the first value will be printed, only then it will check for the post increment or pre increment.
Yes, in case of loop, the starting index would be taken into consideration, and then only it will, you know, get incremented to a new value. So it will not have any difference if I do I plus plus or plus plus I. It would be the same in this case. Hello?
Yeah, yes, sir. Ravi.
So, Sunita, it is clear to you also, right?
Yeah, Ravi.
Okay. So, we cannot
try to keep that concatenation that plus is there, right? There itself, if we give a I plus plus.
No, it will not allow you to do it because that would be like an assignment and you cannot do that in a print statement. You have to do it with a variable. If you want to check, I can create a variable for you. Just do it. You see, there is int c equal to 1, okay? Now, if I want to increment it, so I would create a new variable, int d equal to plus plus c. Now, if I print d over here, if you want to see this, hello? So when I run this, you can see the value is 2.
Okay.
I have to do something like this in order to work with the variables, because this thing will work only with variables and will not work inside a for loop statement. Or if you want to print it with a string statement, you have to do something else. If you want to test it with a print statement, you can also do that. There is another way. I would show you that as well. Instead of this, you can have one more parenthesis over here. Now it will allow you to, you know, use it, as you can see. Right?
Yeah.
We'll see. Thank you. something like this, and I just put hello.co. Hello, really good. That's it. So now it should be like 1, 2, 3 for me. Okay.
Okay.
See this. It has value of 1. Initially, C has a value of 1, but since I'm pre-incrementing it, it will first increment and then only print the value. That is how it happens. Pre-increment. Now, if I add a post-increment operator over here, you see, it will again print 2 only, if you want to see this. Even if I have this operator, it is still printing 2 only. But if I have a pre-increment operator here as well, it will increment the value of 2 to 1 once again, and it will print as 3. See this, 3, 2, again 3. So you are able to get this now? Hello?
Yeah, Ravi.
So pre-increment and post-increment operators are clear to you all guys, okay?
Yeah.
And so this was the last topic for the day. We would be covering the remaining of the conditional loops in the next session, as well as inheritance and abstraction. And if time permits, we would take a look into some more concepts of Java, like file handling. And I really request you guys to have your laptops or systems in place for the next session, because that would be more practical oriented. And you guys have to practice,
yeah,
and get hands-on properly so that you are able to understand the concepts, because the theoretical part is not that, you know, interesting in Java. It's what you practice, and it's only then that you would be able to understand.
Okay.
Okay.
When we will be getting the recording today's class?
I think that Shivangi would be able to tell you, because she is recording this session.
Okay.
So we would be meeting once again next week on Saturday. Again, I think at 1 o'clock itself. So request you guys to have desktops or laptops in place, so, and with all the softwares installed, as I've mentioned to you guys today, practice. And
slides, you were saying that you will share that.
I mean, I would be sharing the link for this slide, because this slide is present on SlideShare, as you can see this.
Okay.
I would be sharing the link.
You can share it with us, that notepad, whatever you are.
Yeah. Right. I would mail this to Shivangi, and she would be mailing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I hope the things that we have discussed today that are more or less clear. In case you find any problems or you come across anything that you are not clear with, you can always contact me or mail me. I would try to reach out to you as soon as.
Okay.
Okay. So we are...